introduce Stephan Bergmann. He's going to be talking to us about the efforts to make LibreOffice sort of more reusable than other projects, I think. So, over to you.
Okay. Yeah, hi, Sunday morning crowd. I'm Stephan Bergmann, working for Red Hat, working on LibreOffice. And in this talk, I'll give an update of how we try and succeed in getting LibreOffice bundled as one of the apps for PPTG app. So if you've been to any of the talks in the last 2 days, you probably already know what PPTG app is. Alex had the introductory talk about it, so I'll just keep it short here and just quote what's on the project's wiki page anyway. So XCG app is really about two things, especially for us as an application from our point of view. There's two aspects to it. One thing is that it gives us the chance to have a kind of a stable baseline against which we can build LibreOffice just once, and with a hope to have it then run on every of the various Linux distros, which do have their differences. So it's traditionally been kind of hard for us to make that smooth. And the other part of XCG app is to sandbox applications in a way that they can't do harm to your machine, harm to the other apps, harm to your data. And that of course implies that the apps need to adapt a little to the way the sandbox works. And that's the main part where we need to do the work to make this smooth. So that's XCG app on the one hand, LibreOffice on the other hand. We're a kind of huge application with millions of lines of code. We have a long history for over 20 years, 30 maybe, already reaching it. Then our complexity matrix of what you can do with this code base is enormous. Like we have, I counted it, about 300 configure switches. Of course, not every combination does make sense, but that shows you the problems that you run into if you just naively start to build on a random platform, want to build LibreOffice there. We have so many configure checks and then so many ways to configure it. We also depend on quite a number of external projects, underlying libraries, that is from simple header-only stuff like Boost for C++ to a complete Python 3 version that we can bundle if there's none on the system. Can't even write Python for that. And then there's more application-specific libraries, like many of the import-export filters for the various file formats that are out there. Traditionally, they are core parts of LibreOffice, but in the past few years, people started to make those into additional projects so that also other applications can make use of that code. So there's quite a number of code that per se does not belong to LibreOffice proper, but in places where we can't depend on it being available on the platform, we've kind of integrated it into our build system to make it easy to build that as part of LibreOffice. And that also benefits us here, because not all of these are available in the XCG app runtime. Then we also have truckloads of localizations, I think around 100 different locales for which we have more or less complete translations. And as I said, huge code base, huge matrix of how you can shoot yourself in the foot with it when you don't configure it properly. We have like this saying in our community that whatever tool chain out there, we manage to break it in subtle ways. So from an intrinsic kind of point of view, it is of course a motivation for us, if there's any new technology out there, to see how we fare against that and whether we can break it or make it succeed. Me, myself, much of the time, I'm using LibreOffice, not as an end user at all, don't know how to run that program, how do you know it, but I like that there's such a vast amount of C++ code, so when I dream up some compiler plugin for the compilers to test against some specific code that is maybe ugly and should be changed, then I'm sure that I'll find in this huge amount at least two or three places where we do trigger that plugin. So, yeah, let's see how we can make these two, or combine these two. As I said in the outset, one part is packaging up the application so that it has a certain well-defined kind of environment that it can depend on, set of libraries that are available on the system. And that benefits us very much, as I said. There is this one entity called TDF, the Document Foundation, that is kind of the legal entity behind LibreOffice. And for an office suite that is cross-platform and available on Windows and Mac as well, people expect to go to some website and download it from there. So we need to provide builds for these various platforms. And that's quite kind of easy for Mac and for Windows, where we like have a baseline. We just dropped Windows XP the other day, but you can say baseline is Windows Vista, and we can depend on what's available there and make builds that work on all the different Windows versions. For Linux, unfortunately, the situation is a bit more fractured. Starts with simple things like RPM or the dev, so we do two builds actually, and package them in different ways. Then there's some libraries that are just not there on all the versions, so we kind of settled on a rather old baseline for now. But effectively, what we're doing is we're using CentOS 5, or used to use CentOS 5, do our builds again, so that means there is no GTK3, for example. We still have a backend to read and write data via the outdated GNOME VBS instead of the more modern GIO stack. So we have two of these stacks for now, and with one configure switch at build time have to decide what we use. And so the builds that you can get off the LibreOffice website, the TDF builds there, kind of crippled by design to run on really old machines. And on the other hand, of course, all the Linux distros include their own LibreOffice version, which is not crippled, of course, so our Fedora version does support GNOME VFS and now also does support GTK3, as we learned from Quentin. But people still want to be able to download the latest versions nightly, so that they can test, for example, them, or if they are on a distro that is really old or doesn't provide proper LibreOffice builds, then they're happy that they can get them from us. And another use case that might be interesting for us is that one of the LibreOffice guys came up with the idea, I have a fat machine, I have a big hard disk, I know how Git works, let's just do lots of nightly builds of LibreOffice and put them all, not the source code, but the resulting binaries into a Git repo. And now we have a huge, or a set of huge Git repos. And the cool thing is, Git bisect works pretty well on these. So checking out a different binary version of LibreOffice is pretty cool for that. So if you have some bug and want to track down which version introduced it, you just take this huge Git repo and do a Git bisect on it, and pretty quickly find out the bad version. It's not all versions that get built, of course, but then you have a set of maybe 20 to 30 commits, and then it's easy to find out the culprit. And the problem with that is that it's, as I said, some volunteer people who do have the hardware, who do want, like in winter, have a warm house, so they're happy with running their machine full speed to crunch all these builds. And sometimes some dependency on the build environment does sneak in, so they make mistakes with the 300 configure switches, and then there's one where we now depend on one library from their machine, from their distro, that is differently named on the other distros. So for example, with the one Git repo we have, there's the traditional knowledge that if you're, it was built against Ubuntu, I think, and if you're on Fedora, you need to symlink one system library to a different name, and the versions just match fine. It's just a name that doesn't. So, and of course that guy doesn't go back and fix this one configure switch and redo all the builds, because by now he has a warm house and it's summer now. So it's not realistic to redo that stack. But if XDG app is up and working for that, it would be trivial, of course, to do these builds as XDG app builds and be more certain that what you deliver there will run everywhere. And I guess also that the OS tree underlines of XDG app will probably, that's a kind of good thing also, will make it maybe even easier to get that good repo set up. Let's see. So if you actually try to build LibreOffice, there's a few obstacles in the way. That's mostly due to the runtime, the SDK for XDG app against which you build your application. That's not like Fedora or CentOS or RHEL or whatever. It's some Yocto distro, kind of project distro, which is mostly targeted and embedded. So it has some peculiarities and some quirks into which we ran. As you know, we managed to break every toolchain. So trivial examples, like there's one Perl thing that we need during build time that's just not there. So I just took that Perl file and then just for building LibreOffice, I manually copied it into the SDK. We had dependencies on Glue in the code, that OpenGL abstraction thing, and that's not there, but it was only three or four places where we needed it for trivial things, so I managed to get that cleaned out even from our code base. There was one strange thing that took me quite a while to track down. One of our external projects that we need includes this Redland XML meta parsing stuff. They have dependency on libxml, and the libxml config, they don't use package config, they use XML config, and the version that was included in Yocto, that just is a hard-coded shell script to always exit once or always signal a failure. So the Redland project that we built internally in LibreOffice failed to configure properly, so I worked around that with a hack in that configure file for that Redland. But that's only that's the only two things I actually need to manually clean or fuck up, the XML config one and the thing, and then we work out of the box there. I disable some of the stuff that we have, like for example, we have GStream 0.10 and GStream 1.0 backend, and we can choose between those. And, well, I don't know which reason, I just try to configure LibreOffice in some of those F dependencies that are not met yet on that code base. For example, also no cuts, but there's no printing yet anyway for the sandboxed scenario. The biggest missing part, or not in size of functionality anymore, but in code size probably, is that there's no Java runtime included. But it turns out that in LibreOffice we use less and less Java. We do use it for some database stuff, and there's some kind of wizards that allow you to translate documents from one format to another, or some kind of example wizards that are still in Java. Much of that has been rewritten as Python anyway. And there's extensions from third parties that are written in Java, so they don't get blocked under Jam. So most of the, as I said, we have like 100 external projects that we can build as part of LibreOffice. I got it cut down to like 30 of them were not present on the Octo baseline, so I need to still build them as part of the LibreOffice build. But the others that are relevant on the Linux get taken from the runtime. Still X11 based. We're moving ahead for GDK3 for Wayland. So that'll change at one point in the future as well, because if we learn X11 is inherently not sandboxable, not secure, but we're heading there anyway. Yeah, if you do all that, take the resulting installation tree, it's a bit fat at 350 megabytes. And that's only the English version. So there's no translations into any other of the 100 languages in there. I'm not sure whether you want to have different packages in the end for the different, or like different builds for different platforms, for different languages, or just one set that will include all the languages. I'm not sure, like for example, on the Windows MSI bundle that we offer for download, that does include all the languages, and that installation time on the Windows, you just select the part of the languages that are relevant for you. So people do accept to download a monster of that size. So it looks like it's not too much of a problem in this day and age. So the second part of the puzzle is actually making use of sandboxing features. So what you have when you just build it, you have the LibreOffice. I'll just give you a demo shortly. That looks and feels just like your average model, and depending on how you configure the XTGF sandbox, it will allow you access to your whole RSS files anyway, or you'll have an experience where you can't do nothing with it because you just have access to the LibreOffice files themselves and not to your documents in your home directory. The reason why sandboxing is of benefit for us, this one model with XTGF is that you find a random game on the internet and download it and don't want it to compromise your security or install malware on your system. So that's not the probably not the thing that users of LibreOffice are concerned with. They do trust that what we deliver to them is not a malware, junkware app. But then again, when you open a random document, it might be that it triggers by accident or by on purpose some bug in our hub, in our software stack. So for the typical use case, then you get a document in the mail or from the internet somewhere and want to view that. It can well be a benefit to have LibreOffice sandboxed so that if there's any damage done, it is confined to the sandbox. And as I said, the main issue for an application like LibreOffice that is concerned with the creating and displaying documents is, of course, how to get access from within the sandbox to the files, to your documents that matter to you. So the model used there is that the idea is if you actively, as a user by the UI, grant access to a file in some piece of code that runs outside the sandbox, that that is an implicit sign that you want to give the sandbox code access to that file, for example, for opening. So what happens is you have the file open, the file chooser dialog, not run within the sandbox, but run outside, communicate by a dbus with the sandbox code, have full access to your to the view of all your files there, select one of those files, and then let that external code, external to the sandbox, grant access or give a channel to the sandbox to just read that one file. In theory, it will also be interesting to have that when you run, when you start LibreOffice on the command line and pass a document on the command line, you will also probably expect that you have access to it. So that's a use case. The second one that's not yet covered, concentrating for the moment at the GUI approach of opening a file picker to choose a document. And I'll switch to the demo probably so that you'll get an idea what I'm talking about all the time. So this is LibreOffice running within the sandbox now. I did a debug build, so it's a lot of noise there. I can do the full screen. So you can open and write a document, for example, but when you try to open some existing document, and you see, I'm not seeing the back maybe, that your home directory is completely empty. You don't have anything there because we are sandboxed. The computer has just this our app. So we do have some, like we have some credits file in here. So like we could open that. Said it's not responding. But it does stop the recovery dialog. So what can you expect? So what we have anyway inside LibreOffice is like we have our own implementation of file open dialogs, and we can use the system ones like the GDK version or on Mac, the Mac specific one. So what I did in this build is that the LibreOffice internal one, I hacked that. So if I use that one, then try to open a file, then this, what I just said, this sandbox reaches out via Dbus to some file chooser scenario, kicks in, and there I have access to all of my files. Like I have my complete home directory here, I have my documents folder, I have some test file that hopefully does open. And there we are. So we do manage to get some data from outside. We have some peculiarities in LibreOffice, like other apps that are just interested in the content of a file. They are happy with reading that file, or they will even be happy maybe with an open file descriptor to read data from. We think that if we have a file on your hard disk, then we know that we can do more things like place some log file next to it into which we record various data, like who has this file open, so that if you have a shared directory and then multiple people want to open that document, that we can display a nice dialogue to them and say, your colleague blah 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 has already opened it, you can only open it read only. And in Calc, the spreadsheet app, there's even some mode where there's some controlled mode where you can do some limited kind of collaboration, and that works by tracking in that log file multiple users that are working concurrently on a document. So that doesn't work here at the moment. So the logic inside of LibreOffice decides that it can't create its log file, so it opens it as a read-only mode document. And if we change it, it doesn't even allow us to save it. What now want to only offer save as, and yeah, then it wants to give us a place where we can save it to, but the file picker dialog for now only allows to choose an existing place. I think it won't even work to override that. Let's see. This is where the demo ends for now, but this is work that I'm confident we'll get covered to get this working. Other things are, of course, printing, for example, where we do need some portal to start with at all. Yeah, as I said, these log files and the logic around them. So this file choosing mechanism that I just demoed, that's already the second approach to it. The first one was based on some GDFS-based special kind of URLs, which for us as LibreOffice would have had the benefit that we do have code to, for example, read from WebDAV or from FTP, so we do know that different URL protocols have different or allow different kind of access to the data. So for WebDAV, for example, or for FTP, we wouldn't try these log files anyway, so we have logic in the code looking whether it's in a file URL or any other kind. So if we would have used these special document URLs, then we would have shortcut all that file system specific logic inside LibreOffice anyway. So now we'll need to take tweaks there and see how to get it working. And some more things, as I mentioned, the localizations. So I mentioned the Java stuff. I don't know how we'll cover that, for example, or just leave it out. As I said, we have less and less functionality depending on it, as more and more of the write once, run everywhere stuff is now covered by Python instead of Java. We do have one other thing where we use a socket communication between various, if you start multiple instances of LibreOffice, then we need to be careful that only one of them actually runs, because otherwise they would corrupt the per-user data. We don't have any safeguards there to have only one of them write atomically. So what we do is have the first instance listen on a Unix socket, and all the other ones first checking if there's an open socket yet, and then shoving the command line there so that the first instance takes over and displays whatever document was given on the command line. And that's maybe we can use dbus for that or something. So that should also be not too difficult to get sandboxed. And yeah, that's about it. So, questions?
Now, I was just mentioning that you can use the gapplication class in DIO for the unique instance. It has a Libas API to handle exactly the use case you just mentioned. So you depend on glib anyway, right? So
yeah.
In fact, that's probably what, I don't know if you want to use exactly that code, but there's a well-defined Dbus API for this kind of thing that is also involved in the more modern way you get launched from a desktop file.
Yeah, you would assume that there is something like that in there. Yeah.
I think if there are no more questions, then thank you very much for your talks.
Thank you.